Hello, people of the internet. Today I'm going to be talking about something kind of different I've never really talked about before, and I want to do a topic on one of my favorite bands of all time, and their name is The Laws.
Their debut self-titled album came out in 1990 and would be their only album release. So what happened? Well, that happened. But in order to figure out why this happened, we have to go back to 1983, to The Laws' origins.
What? Yeah, okay, you ready to record now? Go on then.
There's The Laws' future singer-songwriter Lee Mavers. He joined the band in 1984 after the band was formed in 1983 by Mike Badger. And here we'll take a listen to some of the early stuff.
She'd look well on the grass in the wild. Her breath shows in the chill of this air.
The band later had bassist John Power join the band, and The Laws evolved around the trio of Badger, Mavers, and Power until Badger left in 1986. Following Badger's departure, in 1987, The Laws signed to a record label called Go Discs, where they released multiple singles and eventually an album. The band's first single was released in 1987 titled Way Out. Way Out shows what kind of songwriter Lee Mavers is with some interesting changes throughout the verse and the chorus. The next single released in 1988 titled There She Goes is perhaps The Laws' most popular single, although this release is not the most popular, as the most popular release came later. The Laws released their final single in 1990 titled Timeless Melody, which is another perfect showcase of Lee Mavers' songwriting talent.
Also in 1990, we have the debut album and the only album of this band, self-titled, The Laws. I want to go ahead and take a look at some of my favorite songs from this album and just give you kind of an overview of what kind of material we're working with on this album and some of the great songwriting from Lee Mavers.
I know what you're thinking. You didn't put that song in, their most popular song. Well, I want to explain how I found it first.
So there is an indie artist here by the name of Mac DeMarco who was on a show talking about how he wrote one of his songs, and I'll let him explain the rest to you.
You know what? I was listening to this band from the UK called The Laws. They have that song, There She Was It? There she goes. You know that one. And so I wanted to write a song like that, so I tried. Doesn't sound anything like that.
Yes, this is easily my favorite song, and definitely in my top five songs of all time. And seeing Mac DeMarco talk about that song a little bit, you kind of get the sense of how influential this band has become since their release of the debut album. And here I'm going to show you guys someone who's a bit more famous than Mac DeMarco. You may or may not know him. His name is Noel Gallagher. So let's listen to what he has to say about The Laws.
So the next video is by a band from Liverpool, in the northwest of England, called The Laws. Songwriter in The Laws is a bit of a kind of mystic genius by the name of Lee Mavers. They only made one album, and I've disappeared off the face of the earth ever since. So this is The Laws, and There She Goes. By the way, it's about heroin.
So you notice how he said mystic genius in that? Well, he's kind of right about that, and he also did kind of disappear off the face of the earth, and kind of more speaking of making music-wise. And this is where the story gets real fun and interesting, and this is where we really figure out why Lee Mavers and The Laws didn't make more music and why they could have not been a one-hit wonder.
So, this album did pretty well in the UK. It reached number 30 on the charts. Did not do so well over here in America. It only reached 50,000 copies. Actually, I think it's slightly less than that. So it did not do well at all over here. But considering the success it was getting in the UK, you think the band, the Mavers, would have been happy with it, right? Well, unfortunately, this is where it all gets kind of interesting and weird, because Lee Mavers and the band, specifically Lee Mavers, was pretty unhappy with how this album sounded.
And that's the state that all the recording was up to by the time we left. We jibbed it at about 3 months into it, like, because it was still no better since day one. And somehow, they've even got voices where there wasn't voices and mixed that up as well. So, you know, but still, like, you know, I am embarrassed about it, singing. It's terrible, like, you know what I mean? It's a crow.
If you go on any streaming service, you can find multiple versions of a song that had been recorded by different producers and in different studios and different sessions.
All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take some of the other recordings of those songs that you heard from the album and put them in this video. I want you guys to kind of compare what you heard before and what you're hearing from these other sessions. I'm not going to lie, on some of these songs, I definitely agree with Lee Mavers. I think some of them are definitely better from what they were on the album. So that's just my opinion. So take a listen, see what you think, and maybe you'll find them better as well.
Alright, so now that you've heard some of the differences between those, you can kind of see why Lee Mavers may have got a little angry. It's very notorious now that Lee Mavers was very, very specific and picky on how he wanted these records and songs to sound. And there's even rumored that he didn't want to use a mixing board because it didn't have original 60s dust on it. I hope that's not true. I don't think it is, because if it is, oh my god. That'd be a little interesting if it's true. So even with Lee Mavers' outspoken disappointment and hatred of the album, they still went on a promotional tour for the album for a couple of years. In 1992, John Power left the band, and the band broke up shortly after. The reasoning for John Power's departure from the band is that the band really never got a different set list from 1987, and John Power grew disappointed in that and left. And with good reasoning, John Power went on to form Cass, in which they have some very good songs, which he wrote. So I can't really blame him for that. The Laws reunited shortly in 94, 95, and then again in 2005, and then been a couple of other appearances since then. And here's where things get really disappointing with this band, is there's a lot of demos that came out and unreleased tracks that have been released since the breakup and the album. And some I'd like to mention is like Fishing Net, I Am the Key, and Over. A lot of those songs are just great songs that would have been on their second album, and people like Noel Gallagher have heard this material and said it would have been better than their first album, which does make sense considering usually debut albums aren't the strongest of a band. It's really rare when that happens. But that's why this is so disappointing. He could have wrote so much more, but he just chose not to because he never quite got that right sound in his head onto the record. The rumors back in 2005 and the late 2000s that the Laws were going to put out their second record finally. The reason for this is that the Laws did reunite around this time with John Power, and it was believed that they were going to release a record. Fortunately, it never happened, and it probably never will, which really sucks because it would have been good material. So that's about going to wrap up my little talk here about the Laws. It's really just kind of an unfortunate case of someone who wanted things to be so perfect that he just never got them out at all. So this is by far my greatest what-if band. I really wish they would have made more, but they never have. So I'll deal with what I got, and it's definitely good enough because it's one album full of a lot of good songs. So that's going to wrap up this video on the Laws. Really a great band, and definitely Lee Mavers deserves the title of the Mystic Genius because we really did not ever get to see what he truly envisioned for his band. And since we never got to see what Lee Mavers had in his head, that's the story of the Laws.